Okay, so I guess we should start. So today I want to talk about how to use the machinery that I talked about in the previous lectures to define the virtual fundamental cycles which are relevant for contact homology. So in the two lectures ago, I defined a bunch of atlases on the moduli spaces. And last lecture, I showed how to use these atlases to write down the virtual fundamental cycle. And what I want to do today is say how to use, sort of package all of this information together coherently between the different moduli spaces so that we get something which deserves to be called coherent virtual fundamental cycles on all of the moduli spaces at once. So recall that there's sort of all of the relevant objects are indexed by the set S, which is a collection of trees. So trees T, they're all connected, directed, every vertex. Oh, sorry. Every letter, every vertex has unique incoming edge, along with labels. So the vertices, the edges will be labeled with rabe orbits, and the vertices are labeled with homology classes relative to the rabe orbits. Right, so recall the setup Y is a contact manifold. Lambda is a contact form. P of Y lambda is the set of rabe orbits. And these trees, which look something like this, edges directed downwards, the edges are all labeled with rabe orbits, and the vertices are labeled with homology classes. Rabe orbits.
It's orbit from different points, meaning, or segments. When we say orbit, you mean the full orbit or segment of orbit?
So the whole orbit, so like just a closed trajectory of the rabe field. Not necessarily simple. So it could be multiply covered.
Closed orbit.
Closed orbit. Yeah.
Closed orbit. Okay.
Yeah. Right. So S. Right. So remember, for every T, we have some moduli space, M of T, which is set of holomorphic curves. In R cross Y, they're sort of modeled on T to mean that sort of the T is the dual graph of the domain, and the labels are compatible with the map. So that is this tree corresponds to as two-story holomorphic curve.
When you say curve, you mean up to parameterization or with parameterization, right?
Up to parameterization, yeah. And we also modulate quotient by sort of translation in the R direction here. Yeah. Yeah, so then this is gamma plus. So S is not just a set, it has a bit more structure. So S is a category so morphisms T to T prime morphism is a contraction of edges. So here there's only one edge you can contract. You get a morphism from this to a single vertex tree. This corresponds to the gluing holomorphic curves. S also has some sort of vaguely monoidal structure. Instead of writing this, let me just say it has concatenations. I'll say exactly what that means. So given any collection.
What is this word? Yes, what is this long word? I can't see.
Concatenations. So if you have a bunch of guys, trees, and you pick some matching between the pairs of input and output edges such that the result is connected and is a tree, you can get a new tree. So this will be denoted like this. So now given the structure, we could write down what the compactification of these moduli spaces looks like. So you simply take the union over all trees mapping to T. This disjoint union takes into account sort of all possible degenerations of a curve of type T. What can happen is it can split. And so now the theorem of Bourgeois, Eliashberg, Hofer, Rosatsky, Zender is that the space is compact. Right, so the space M bar of T behaves well under these operations. That is to say, if you have a morphism, this induces an inclusion compactified moduli spaces, and if you have a concatenation, this induces map, really an isomorphism. Moduli spaces. These are essentially tautological given this definition. Okay, now what I want to do is sort of abstract away these two properties, because it's going to turn out that most of the objects we're going to study have similar functoriality to the moduli space itself. So we'll say an S module.
But you have no bubbles in this picture,
yeah? So the symplectization is exact, so there'll be no bubbles. You could...
But they might have relative bubbles, however.
Yeah, if you're doing a cobordism, you could have a bubble there. So if you have bubbles, then the only thing that really has to change here is the definition of the moduli space. You have to allow bubbles. But I won't record the bubbles in the trees because they're somehow. So an S module is a functor X from this category S to any symmetric monoidal category. Along with for every concatenation, natural maps from the tensor product of x of ti to x of.
It's not only mean tensor product, the expression being tensor product, so I mean category or not?
Not necessarily. I'm just using this to denote the whatever the operation is. For instance, here it's product on compact Hausdorff spaces. Not necessarily. Right, and so we need the following sort of natural compatibility relation, I J.
It's co-covariant,
say covariant, but I mean, it's swapping C for C op. It doesn't really matter. So if you have x, I, j, this should commute. This just means if you have a bunch of trees and you can concatenate them in two steps, that's the same as concatenating them in all at once. So, examples. So one, this m bar, the moduli space from S to the category of compact Hausdorff spaces with the product symmetric monodal structure is an S module for essentially the reasons I just said up here. Last time I defined a set, an index set A bar for the implicit atlases on these.
It's concatenation of the trees depend on the choice of the branches, yeah? Right? The operation is an ordered tree, so at least it's an ordering of
A concatenation takes in, I'm leaving something out of the notation here. I write just sort of a collection of trees, but really, as part of the data, is a matching of the edges.
Matching the edges, yeah. Okay. So it's not just binary operation, plus extra structure.
Yes, yeah.
But when you say it's fun to solve which one you choose, so how you, when you find this, on the right hand side, definite operation, on the left hand side, it depends on extra data. So if category has some, so this, mentioned, must be on every tree already, they might be choosing a branch of it.
So what I mean is that for every choice of matching, you get a map like this, and maybe it's different. So if you have a collection of trees, there's this tensor product.
But if you have a tensor product for trees, you need to basically choose matching in simultaneously for pairs, or you choose each tree, you choose a branch, which you match with that branch. How would you choose?
So wherever.
With matching depends on pairs.
Yeah.
But if you want to still have probably have object which individual.
Yeah. The concatenated object depends on how we matched.
Yes.
And so for every choice of matching, there's a map like this.
Depending on this matching.
Yeah. I mean, the right hand side depends on the matching. So of course, the map has to.
Also depends on the matching.
No, this is.
It's not dependent on the matching. All the same. You have the same result.
Yeah.
I will share with the matching the same result.
The left hand side? Yes, I mean the left-hand side doesn't involve the matching. It's just the tenth. I mean, the monoidal structure on the right here is symmetric. So there's no choice there.
So you can't say that you have trees with preferred branches, and then matching automatic, and then the whole thing is why, and then the actually choice of that. No, I don't want to say it. Because when you take matching, it's pair. You choose pair of objects, and this is not a set. So choosing pairs in different. You know, it's completely so how you do the different worlds,
I guess you could, this is the way I formalize it. I'm sure that we can formalize it in other ways too. Yeah. So. So last time I defined a the index set of the Alices, and it's also an S module from S to opposite category of sets, the disjoint union symmetric moduli structure. So let me say, explain a little bit more about two. So recall that we defined some A of T. This was an index set, just index set, indexing what I called thickening datums, which were the data we needed to write down certain transverse thickenings of the moduli space. And then we defined A bar of T to be the disjoint union over all subtrees. So subtrees meaning connected subtrees. So that is, I choose some set of vertices, I take all the edges incident to one of those vertices and demand that that be connected. So this is A of T, and just by definition, it has this S module structure. So if you have a map from T to T prime, then any subtree of T prime pulls back to a subtree of T. So you get a map in the opposite direction. And similarly, if you have a concatenation, any subtree of one of the TIs gives you a subtree of the concatenation. So you have maps like this. Great. Okay, so before giving sort of the outline of the construction of virtual fundamental cycles, I just need one more definition. So we will say that an object of this category is effective if and only if this compactified moduli space effective is not empty. So I really mean the compactified moduli space, not the non-compactified moduli space. It's possible to have since these moduli spaces are not necessarily cut out transversally, it's a priori and in practice probably possible to have a given tree whose non-compactified moduli space is empty, but yet which has some non-empty boundary strata. So it's important to take compactification here. Right, so this is, so henceforth, we will write S, but we'll actually mean the full subcategory of effective objects. So that is if the moduli space is empty, we just ignore those completely. This is needed just so that this category has good finiteness properties. If you have a given tree, you can just sort of write down this infinite tower of morphisms to it just by splitting many, many times. And in practice, this doesn't happen for holomorphic curves because of the compactness result. And we're going to need to do sort of lots of inductive arguments by induction on trees. And this, if we had to, we want to take advantage of the fact that this can't happen.
You prove the induction, what kind of statements? Induction for proving?
So, for instance, like constructing maps between S modules, we'll construct it by induction on T. And it's ordered by, so they sort of, when you want to define the map for a tree like this, it has to be defined for every tree mapping to it already. And So let me now give a sort of outline of the construction. High level outline of what we're going to do. So the first thing we want to do is consider
what's abbreviation VF?
Virtual fundamental cycles. So we'll consider the map of S modules. So for any tree T, we have this thing which I defined last time called virtual cochains on the moduli space with respect to a given implicit atlas on that moduli space. And we showed, furthermore, that this is quasi-isomorphic, canonically quasi-isomorphic, to check cochains. With coefficients in the orientation module of this, but let me leave that out of the notation for now. And what we also defined is we defined a map on this virtual cochain complex to chains on the Tom space of this vector space, the direct sum of all the obstruction spaces. So this is some finite dimensional vector space. This is just quasi-isomorphic to Z. Right. So one thing we'll have to do today is, so what we did last time is we defined this map for any particular T. We defined a map like this, which under these quasi-isomorphisms is exactly the virtual fundamental cycle. This is simply the definition of a virtual fundamental cycle. This was roughly analogous to defining, let's say, the Euler class of a vector bundle by pulling back the Tom class. And what we need to do now is make sure that this construction is appropriately compatible with all of the ways you can concatenate and map trees to other trees. And if it's appropriately compatible on the chain level, we'll conclude that these.
At which moment do you be invariant on the change of the contact form? Yeah, it must be, after all, still depends on the form. Yeah, what do you think?
So the result that we're trying to prove is something like this. So we have, so for any y lambda j, there exists a set theta of y lambda j, non-empty, along with, for all elements of that set, virtual moduli counts. Depending on theta. Such that satisfying these master equations, d squared equals zero, et cetera.
But at which moment do you have invariance with respect to change in lambda? Some moment, right? You have to do it.
Yeah. So there's an analogous theorem. So it's not part of this statement. It's not even part of the statement that the homology you get is independent of the choice of little theta. There's an analogous theorem for an exact symplectic cobordism, and for a one parameter family of exact symplectic copertism. You can count curves in all of these and get a chain map and a chain homotopy. And if you take all these together, you can show that it's independent of the context.
I've got these similar statements in the relative case for cobordisms.
Yeah.
And then, of course, then you have an invariant.
Yeah, cobordisms and for one parameter family cobordisms. Okay. Once you have all of these, you get invariants.
Okay.
But it doesn't. Yeah, it doesn't follow from any. Yeah. Yeah. Right. So. High-level outline is the following. We define this. So last time I defined this, sort of, say, for any individual tree. And what we have to do now is make it a map of S modules. And once it's a map of S modules, so the fact that this is a map of S modules implies the following properties of these virtual fundamental cycles. So the boundary of a given guy is the sum over all the codimension one boundary strata of the corresponding virtual fundamental cycles, and the virtual fundamental class of a space, which is a moduli space of multi-story curves, is simply the product of the classes of the of each of the trees you started with. So, if one defines virtual fundamental cycles with these properties, one very easily defines, say, the virtual moduli counts, the ones in degree zero that give this in the master equation. So this is somehow the goal, to construct cycles satisfying these coherence properties. Okay, and the point is just that these coherence properties are encoded in the fact that this is a map of S modules. Right, so to make this precise, there are a few tasks we have to do. So first, we have to define both of these complexes as S modules and the map between them. And second, we have to define these horizontal quasi-isomorphisms as quasi-isomorphisms of S modules, that is, compatible with morphisms and concatenations. And then we have this map, which is what we want. Right. So, right. So now,
the last line you wrote. So this product happened in Czech cohomology of M bar of the.
I guess it happens in.
Do you need to push it to somewhere to get this equality?
And this is just like the Kunneth product of like on homology. It's something like chains on X cross chains on Y goes to chains on X cross Y. Some map.
Go to the spaces F bar of the sum of TIs and.
Yeah,
is this really the same as the product? Or
there's a quotient. I mean, there's a map.
There is a map.
And it's quotient by Z mod, the product of Z mod covering multiplicities for the ambiguity. Right, so first, let's say, let's answer the question, how is sort of check cochains? An S module. So there are no push forward maps for this, at least not obviously. Because if you have sort of T prime mapping to T, that gives you an inclusion of M bar of T as a boundary stratum of this. And this is sort of a map going in the wrong direction. So what it really is some sort of connecting homomorphism. Like if it's codimension one, it really is the co-boundary map on cohomology. So to write this down on the chain level, we need to sort of pick a different model of check cochains. So we replace it with the following.
The M tai T, the moduli space of all curves, yeah?
Yeah.
Where you also vary the structure in the surfaces, yeah?
Yeah, yeah. Right. So this long total complex is quasi-isomorphic to this. So how do we see this? So this is quasi-isomorphic. Quasi-isomorphic because you can check the same thing on the level of sheaves. If you just look at sort of right, Z where J is the inclusion of M bar minus the boundary to M bar, then this sheaf, this check cochains is check cochains of this sheaf is quasi-isomorphic to this complex. There's a resolution where you take Z on everything and then a direct sum of Z. This is on M bar of T prime, everything of codimension one, and then keep going like this.
So the dots on the right hand side, they mean you have morphism. What is the next term? Can you write the next?
It's everything of codimension two. It's the same thing, it's just one replaced with two. So I could have written this also as direct sum just of all of the guys here of check cochains on. Of this. I wrote it like this because I'm saying the boundary map sort of goes like this. So with this model, it's clear what the push forward maps for T prime mapping to T are, because you sort of simply see the subcomplex for a given T prime mapping to T as inside this complex for T. And this realizes all of these co-boundary maps on the chain level. Right, so there's an important subcomplex of this, which I'll single out. And I'll call it QS of T, which will be the sum where I just take, right, so this is a resolution. I just take the constant sections in each of these guys. So this is the complex Z goes to sum over all guys codimension 1 going to sum of all guys codimension 2, etc. And this is a subcomplex of this, where I just simply take star equals, or I just take the degree zero part of each of these cochains. So this is somehow the the subcomplex of this generated by characteristic functions of closed strata. And the boundary is somehow, as you expect it to be, the boundary. The boundary is sort of the generator of a given T prime is the sum over all codimension 1 boundary strata of that tree T prime. So now what we'd like to do is we will define a map from QS to this complex virtual cochains M bar real boundary. That is to say, one would really sort of like to have this quasi-isomorphism, but in order to define virtual moduli counts, all you really care about is evaluating these virtual fundamental cycles on characteristic functions of closed strata. We're not sort of evaluating more general cohomology classes on the moduli space. So this complex sees enough of the cohomology that we just use this. So it's not so difficult to check that there's a map of S modules from Q adjoin S to Q. So Q of S is this complex, very, very explicit, has this differential. Q is the S module, which is just Q for every tree with the sort of identity map as the functorial action. And for concatenations, the map is just product. A map of S modules like this is exactly the data.
Is it concatenation is close to what in Q?
Multiplication.
Multiplication.
Yeah.
What is this S in Q adjoint S?
It's the same S. I just didn't write it. It's this S. So this is exactly the data of numbers for those trees of virtual dimension 0, satisfying this sum equals 0 for stuff of dimension 1. So this is some another advertisement for this notion of an S module. I claim that this notion of an S module really incorporates all the sort of the relevant data of how all these moduli spaces fit together. And this is one instance of this fact, if we just have this sort of very concrete complex, which is sort of built from the strata of all the moduli spaces, and then the map of S modules is exactly the same as virtual moduli count satisfying the equation you want. And somehow this equation is encoded in the boundary operator on this space. Okay, so what I need to do now, okay, so what I'll do now is tell you how to define this as an S module. So defining So we'd like to just take what I wrote. Unfortunately, some of the maps go in the wrong direction. So if we're given a map of trees from T to T prime, what we get, so recall that there's an inclusion of this moduli space into this one. This one has an implicit atlas A bar of T. This one has an implicit atlas A bar of T prime. Inclusion of atlases goes in the other direction, though. When you have this tree, there are more thickening datums you can use. And you don't want to forget about all of these. And this inclusion is compatible with the subatlas, but not with these more general datums. So what you get is the following. So there's a map from M bar of T, a boundary. So we have our complexes like this. Now there's increasing or inflation of the atlas quasi-isomorphism from M bar from sort of using just this smaller subset of thickening datums, and then this is the push forward map we want to use. So unfortunately, there's no way we want this map. But there's no way to define this canonically because this is quasi-isomorphic, it goes in the wrong direction. So to fix this, we have to take some replacement for these complexes like this. Okay, so make the following definition. So this new model of virtual cochains where I won't write the atlas is defined as following. Okay, so what's going on here? So let me say what we should do just in this very simple example here. Suppose we only have two trees, T and T prime. And suppose we want to define these two complexes such that we have a push-forward map like this. So obviously, if I take these original definitions, it doesn't work. So so to make this work, we can simply redefine the target, namely this complex, to be the following mapping cone. Where you take virtual cochains with this atlas. So this is what we want. We want to replace this by something. So we replace it with the following mapping cone. So this map, I basically just redo the same diagram. This map from this complex to this complex is a quasi-isomorphism. So at least up to quasi-isomorphism, these just cancel, and we're left with this. So this whole mapping cone is simply quasi-isomorphic to this subcomplex. On the other hand, there's tautologically a map from this complex into the mapping cone by inclusion here. What we do here is we replace this complex with something which is a bit more complicated. But what we gain is these push-forward maps for induced by morphisms of trees. Right, so there's a subcomplex where we just take p equals 0 and t0 equals tp equals t. And this then is virtual cochains on m bar of t rel boundary. And this is a quasi-isomorphism for essentially the same reason as it was a quasi-isomorphism here. The quotient has a filtration by contractible cones, which are just contractible. It has a filtration whose associated graded is contractible because it's just a direct sum of cones of quasi-isomorphisms from increasing the size of atlases. So this is, you can think of this as some sort of explicit model for a homotopy colimit. So now we can make a similar definition.
In this situation above, so when you write things like m bar of t using atlas a bar of t prime, you have this inclusion of atlases a bar of t prime. Yeah. And this the smaller atlas is still covering everything.
So the smaller atlas is still satisfies the covering axiom.
And then in the definition which is hidden here, you don't have a bar in the notation for the on the left hand side, but you somewhat have this compatible system of addresses with inclusion, which is implicit in the notation.
Yeah. Right, so we can make a similar definition for this complex. So this chain group has a similar deficiency. It's not an S module for basically the same reason, and one can fix it up in exactly the same way. So just define chains on this Tom space of T is by definition some, or maybe I won't write it again, some appropriate homotopy colimit of these guys. But again, it's just quasi-isomorphic to Z. Maybe I'll just write this here. So what we've done now is I've actually defined this as an S module. We had to change the definition slightly to something which is quasi-isomorphic to what we wanted. So I'll change the notation. Now this is actually an S module. And now this, again, we had to replace it with something else to make it an S module. So I'll change the notation slightly, but now these are on rigorous footing. We've defined what these are. And now we'd like to start in on defining these quasi-isomorphisms. So this should be quasi-isomorphic to Z. This should be quasi-isomorphic to check code chains. So this is step two. We will construct a map, S modules from this Q join S guy to So I'm not actually going to construct this quasi-isomorphism on the chain level. Rather, I will construct this map on the chain level where we think of this as the subcomplex generated by characteristic functions of the strata. So what do we want this map to satisfy? So given such a map, let's give it a name, W. We get a class in this direct sum of why is this? this is basically why do we get a class here? So this is really the HOM in the category of functors from this over category from Q of S to to this. So this is a natural transformation of functors. We can restrict it to just trees over T, and we get sort of a class here. Simply just sort of taking the action. This just has a bunch of, this is just a free guy generated by trees mapping to T, and this is what you get. Now, if we look at what this complex actually is, this is quasi-isomorphic to check cochains on M bar of T, not relative to anything. Basically, this is, we added up check cochains on each of the strata, each of the open strata, and glued them together in the right way. There's a boundary operator on here. Glued them together in the right way to get check cochains on the whole thing without. And we're going to require that the class of W coincide with the class of just the constant function 1. And what this essentially says is that W, under this quasi-isomorphism here, W corresponds to this this inclusion, where you consider this as a subcomplex of this. So now, to construct the map, construct W by induction on T in S. So what do I mean by that? So for T1 and T2 in S, we're going to say that T1 is less than or equal to T2. If and only if there's some concatenation Ti with T1 isomorphic to some Ti and a map from that concatenation to T2. So the picture is the following. We have a tree T2. If there's a map to T2 from some tree like this, and we think of this as a concatenation, say concatenated out of these two pieces, then we say T1 is less than or equal to T2 for each of those pieces. Now in this case, right, so claim this, if we equip S with this relation, this is a poset. So this requires our assumption, or our restriction to effective trees, because otherwise you can do something okay, let's see why. So transitivity is not difficult. This holds general. Reflexivity is true by definition. You can always get T1 by concatenating T1 with itself and no gluing at all. The real thing to check is anti-symmetry. As usual, when you're defining a poset, anti-symmetry is the most subtle thing to check. So anti-symmetry fails if we just consider arbitrary trees. For the following reason, you can just consider some stupid tree like this. It has a morphism. And okay, so just sort of mess around with the labels. So maybe we label this with say some homology class A. And we can label this, say, A minus B and B. So this, what we conclude is that this tree with the label B is less than or equal to this tree with the label A. But this is true for any A and B, and so we have these relations for any A and B in the homology. That's not very good. It breaks this as long as the homology is non-zero. This can't happen, though, if we only restrict to effective trees. So this holds, assuming T1 and T2 are effective, i.e., these moduli spaces are both non-empty. One way of thinking about this is that if you had a non-trivial, if you could do this with T2 not equal to T1, what you'd have is a concatenation, a non-trivial concatenation for some T1, where T1 itself appears as one of the boundary strata. And this would sort of very wildly contradict compactness. You'd have some space, and where your space cross nether space is a boundary stratum of itself. Compactness also tells us that this poset is well-founded, i.e. there's no infinite decreasing, strictly decreasing chain like this. And this is the property that we need to do an induction. So that, this is an aside, explains what I mean by constructed by induction. Right, so now at the inductive step, we have an extension problem. Lifting. So here's the complex where we want W to live. And we want to, and we already have defined W on all of the trees which are strictly less than T. So this looks like this. So this is W restricted to T prime of codimension. Now we know that this is quasi-isomorphic to check cochains on M bar of T. This is quasi-isomorphic to check cochains on the boundary of M bar of T, where this is the usual restriction map. The homology class of the W here is just equal to 1. And we want the homology class of W here to equal 1. This is now the existence of a lift simply follows from the fact that this is surjective. And the homology class that we want maps to the homology class of the thing we're lifting. So the moral is somehow we can construct maps out of this thing in any particular desired homology class, as long as the homology classes satisfy some reasonable coherence condition. Right, so now step 3 is we need to understand this this quasi-isomorphism here. Right, so this was right, so in step 1 we constructed the map of S modules, which I called W, from this S module to here. That was step 2. Now step 3, we want to work on this quasi-isomorphism. This should be quasi-isomorphic to Z. Okay, so what we'd really like is a map. We'd really like a map to the S module Z with just the trivial structure maps. And we'd like to construct it by induction like before. But this construction is going to fail for the following reason. It fails because this S module is not cofibrant. So let me define what it means for an S module to be cofibrant, and then you'll see why we need
S module cofibrant.
Cofibrant. So an S module X is called cofibrant only if, so first I want all of the concatenation maps to be isomorphisms. And second, I want, so for maximal T, maximal with respect to composition, that is T with a single vertex, i.e. number of vertices of t is 1. The following map is injective. So we take the colimit of x of t prime for all of the t prime over t of codimension at least 1. This should be inject into x of t. Okay, if we were working over the integers or any a ring which is not a field, we would want to require that this be injective with projective co-kernel. But for Q, everything is projective, so we'll just ignore that. Right here, so the target is chain complexes, in case that wasn't clear, with the tensor product symmetric monoidal structure. So cofibrant S-modules are the ones for which somehow the maps out are correct. And the reason why this condition is important is if you're trying to, say, construct a map out of an S-module X, you want to construct it by induction on T. And that sort of at the extension step of that induction, sort of when you're trying to do T, you already have a map defined on here. And if you want to extend it to X of T, at the very least, this map had better be injective. Otherwise, somehow, the map which you already defined might be incompatible with this map. So instead of defining this map, right? I said we can't define this map because this is not cofibrant. So what we have to do instead is we'll define a surjective quasi-isomorphism from something I'll just denote by this. Cofibrant replacement for this, and then we'll define this map that we want to Z by induction.
Don't you want the map to Q?
Yeah, let's do Q. The denominator's everywhere, so every time I write Z, it really should be Q. I forget because I've been sort of glossing over the details where one actually needs to say that one divides by something. Right. Okay, so let me define the cofibrant replacement first. Yeah.
Do you claim that any of the previous S modules that we met were already cofibrant and didn't need a cofibrant replacement?
This one is already cofibrant. This one is cofibrant. Yeah. You know, at one point I spent a lot of time. Thinking about like Eilenberg-Zilber maps to try to prove that this guy was cofibrant, because I wanted to make this argument, but eventually I realized that one really shouldn't. I mean, even if it's true, it's better not to rely on the sort of fine properties of singular chains. I actually don't know whether this is cofibrant. It might be, but somehow this is a subtle question which is better dealt with this way. Well, it's better to do this and so it doesn't come up. Right, so I'll define a cofibrant replacement just for any S module. So forget about this one for the moment. So let X be any S module valued valued in chain complexes as before. So then we define X cofibrant along with a surjective quasi-isomorphism to X as follows. Okay, we define it by induction. On T and S. So at the inductive step, for a given T and S, we have at the inductive step for a given T and S, we have the following. So we have this map from colimit X T prime. This is codimension at least one mapping to X of T. This might not be injective because X might not be cofibrant. Now we've defined X cofibrant for all these T primes. So there's this map, colimit Now, although this map is a quasi-isomorphism, after taking a colimit, it might not be, because this is really colimit, not a homotopy colimit. So we don't know anything about this vertical map. What we want to do is define this guy here. So we want to define X cofibrant of T such that there's an injection here, and this is a surjective quasi-isomorphism. Okay, but now it's just a general fact that any map of complexes, like this diagonal map here, can be factored into an injective map and a surjective quasi-isomorphism. So this X cofibrant that you just simply take to be the mapping cylinder of this guy.
Then when you say any S module, it should be an S module valued in chain complexes.
Yeah. Yeah. So there's some. Yeah. So furthermore, this is even a cofibrant replacement functor. If we have a map of S modules from X to Y, it induces a map from X cofibrant to Y. Cofibrant. Though that's, we won't need that. Right, so this defines this. Now let me define this map. So I'll call this map P. So we will define this map P, of course, by induction. At the inductive step, so that is, we need to extend the following map. Colimit from T prime over T at least one. This cofibrant guy so this injects into cofibrant chains on the Tom space of T we've already defined this map to Q here, and we want to extend it here. So now, here it's not as simple as just saying, as long as it commutes on homology, we're okay. So in order to guarantee the existence of an extension, some sort of elementary homological algebra tells us that we can extend if, and it, in practice, it's if and only if, because what we need. We can extend if one, so it commutes on, right, so this is concentrated in degree zero, this is concentrated in degree zero. This is some mystery. And that this is the problem. So we need it to commute on H0, and we need H sub minus 1 of this colimit to equal 0. This is what's needed. This is another thing which, for some reason, didn't come up in this other inductive argument. So, but both of these are not obvious. So, if you pick any particular T prime, it's clear that this commutes on homology. We have, this is isomorphic to Z, this is isomorphic to Z. And moreover, that these isomorphisms are compatible with this map. Once we take the colimit, there could be H minus 1. There could also be extra H0, which is not generated which is not in the image of H0 of these guys. So this is it's a bit of a problem. But the key observation here is that if, since this is cofibrant, we have to use cofibrancy again to calculate this colimit. So this colimit of stuff of codimension at least 1. This is quasi-isomorphic to the homotopy colimit over the same thing.
What has to commute on H0? The first condition, what does it commute on H0?
So there's some map here, and there's some map here, and I want to extend it. And moreover, I want the action on, there's a specified map, I want this to be on homology. Yeah, so the fact that somehow all the maps from C cofibrant of T to C cofibrant of T prime are injective implies that this colimit is actually the same as the homotopy colimit. And the homotopy colimit is in now the homotopy colimit is invariant under quasi-isomorphism. So since each of these are quasi-isomorphic to Z, we just get the homotopy coelement of Z, which is just chains on the nerve of this category S over T, or rather the full subcategory of stuff which is codimension at least one. So this looks like some complicated answer, but for whatever reason, things work out very nicely because we just want to show vanishing of negative homology, and this is very easy to see. It's also easy to see from this description that sort of the image of H0 of the individual guys here surjects onto H0 of this. It's just saying that push forwards from points surjects onto H0 of the whole complex. And H negative homology of a space vanishes. So this lemma gives these conditions, and we conclude that there exists a map P. So this is almost what we want. There's one last thing to do. So remember, I already remarked that a map of S modules from this guy to this guy is exactly the data of virtual moduli counts. And we almost have a map like that. We have a map from here to here, which we can compose like this. And if this map were just in the opposite direction, we'd be done. So instead, we have to lift it. So we have to make a lift W tilde here. So how do we? So again, construct W tilde by induction. OK, there's no requirement on W tilde other than this diagram commute. Somehow the fact that this is a quasi-isomorphism means that any lift is fine. Any lift will do what we want.
So is it a general property for Coffee Wundt
estimate? I think so. I mean, as long as I made the definition of covibrant correctly, it should be just general property. And moreover, somehow the fact that you can make this lift just comes from a corresponding fact for chain complexes. So at the inductive step, so we need to lift. So we have the colimit of Q adjoin S at T prime, stuff of codimension one. This inject. So here now we're again using the fact that this guy is cofibrant. This injects into Q of S of T. We have a map from Q of S of T here. This is just write chains E of T. This is a surjective quasi-isomorphism. And this is the map W tilde that we've defined so far. Gives us a map to the cofibrant replacement. And what we want is a map like this. OK, so now in this situation, when we have a cofibration and the surjective, and the acyclic fibration. It's just a general property that lifts like this all exists. So this is always exists. So this is the left lifting property in the projective model structure on non-negatively graded chain complexes. So that's what's used in defining this map W. So there's a lot of homological algebra here. In fact, that's mostly what happened today. It was homological algebra. And it's possible that all of this could be, I've been trying to do everything sort of as concretely as possible. It's probable that using a certain amount of machinery, all of this could be reduced to a few lines. But then if you expanded those two lines and understood what they actually mean, it would be something like this. So now let me just say exactly what this set is in this theorem. So an element theta in theta is a choice of P W and W tilde as we constructed. So there were a few requirements. This map had to induce the canonical isomorphism on homology. This map had to correspond to the canonical quasi-isomorphism between this and check cochains. And the diagram had to commute. So those are the conditions. And we also saw, so we proved above that these always exist, i.e. that this is non-empty. And now, sort of given an element theta in capital theta, we get a map of S modules from Q adjoin S the Q, namely P composed with W tilde, which, as I remarked before, is exactly the choices of virtual moduli counts for trees of dimension zero, such that they're compatible with concatenation, and this sum is zero. In these two statements, we just interpret this virtual count as zero if T has virtual dimension, which is not zero. Right, so then this is this is the sort of the final step in the proof of this theorem. Great, so next time, what I want to do is a lot of analysis. So one of the things which I haven't discussed at all so far is gluing, and that's what I'll do next time. Gluing is a inevitably a part of any construction of sort of Fleur homological invariants. What we need to show, and we'll show next time, is that when you have a moduli space of holomorphic curves, that, or at least for the moduli spaces of holomorphic curves relevant for contact homology, if the moduli space is transverse, then locally it's modeled by a manifold with corners. It's basically the product of the space of gluing parameters and the kernel of the linearized operator.